So thanks for joining me for this session on quality control. In this recording, I'm going to be talking about the quality control or QC steps that we apply to genetic data. So this is in the very early stages of a study. We've collected our DNA, it's been transformed into data. We're going to clean that data up and then we will impute and then we can do our statistical analyses. So there's many points in a study that we'll be applying QC. But these steps that we'll be discussing here and in the tutorial are the quality control steps that we apply to our genetic data. So why do quality control? Essentially, poor quality data is going to contribute to false positives and false negatives in our results. So we want robust results. We're going to need to clean our data up. So we'll be removing essentially genotyping errors. These can be errors in the calling of genotypes or the translation of DNA into data. They can be due to lots of different factors. One of the pictures that I like to bring to my own mind was a story given to me by a woman that I work with who was involved in a project where they posted out two spit kits to a couple who were participating in a project. And somewhere in that delivery, one of the kits went missing or was damaged. And so the couple thought, or were trying to be helpful, and both of them spat into the same kit and posted that back to her. So in doing so, they also included a letter to say what they had done. But it was a classic example of DNA contamination. It's an example of human error. After all, we ended up with no usable data from two people instead of having usable data from one person. There is no way that we can disentangle that DNA in that spit kit and say this belongs to that person and this belongs to that person. It's also an example of contaminated DNA. And even if they had not included a letter to say what they had done, the steps that we will go through in the tutorial would be able to identify a problem like this. So we can actually go, okay, this isn't a clear indication of data from a person, a specific person. We can remove that. It doesn't interfere with our analyses. So one of the other things that we'll be doing in the tutorial is after we've cleaned up our data, we're going to have a look at the relationship structure within our data. And whilst that's not necessarily a quality control step, it is a necessary aspect of coming to understand our data so that we can apply appropriate analyses. And that is going to be important for minimizing our false positives and false negatives. So how do we go from DNA to data? I'm a behavior geneticist. I use statistics to analyze data. I have no experience working in a laboratory actually processing the DNA into data. But it is still useful for me to have an idea of these many different steps that are involved and an appreciation of what are the possible sources of error and what exactly does my data represent. So we are able to post out spit kits to participants who can spit into that kit at home, post it back. The sample is then processed so that the DNA is fragmented, it's chopped up into little pieces. And then it's amplified, so we've got more of it, and then DNA is extracted. We can store some, and then we can plate some onto SNP chips or genotyping arrays for it to be then further analyzed. So this down the bottom here, these images come from the Illumina website. This is an example here at A of a SNP chip or a genotyping array. So there are many different forms of SNP chips. The technology is improved over time and I'm sure it will continue to improve. This here is an example of the bead technology. On this particular chip, there is space for information, DNA, from 12 different individuals. These horizontal bars here are each a different individual. Now, if you're thinking then looking at this SNP chip, then if you've got information for multiple individuals, and you'll have many chips and they might be sent off to a DNA genotyping company for processing in different batches. If you are thinking from an experimental point of view, then when, and you've got cases and controls, you want to have your cases and controls randomly allotted to both the chips and the batch runs that they're being processed under. In a similar way, if you have males and females, you want to randomize them across your chips and also your batch runs. That way we can ensure that we can actually pick up any particular batch effects in our data once we've got our data at the end. So back to the chip. For each of these individuals, there will be hundreds of thousands of probes in order to test the alleles at hundreds of thousands of points in the genome, many, 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 many loci. So each of these wells has a bead. This here is a schematic of a bead. So this bead is targeting an allele at a locus. So it has a particular sequence here in address. So this is the order of bases. And then this here is the locus of interest. So once you've got your fragmented DNA, it's going to come along. If it's the right location in the genome, it will bind to this bead. And then depending on if this allele here bonds to this C, so G will bond to C, this bead will fluoresce green. A different bead, it might bond to, if there's an A at that location and a T here, then it will bond this way and it will fluoresce red. So this is how we're establishing at that locus. You might have a G or you might have a T. And if it's a G, it's going to bond to the C and fluoresce green. If it's a T, it will bond to the A and fluoresce red. So this is translating the DNA into a color. This is called an intensity. So if you've got, DNA coming from your biological father, from your biological mother, you've got two alleles at that locus. If your two alleles are the same, you have two G alleles, they're both going to be fluorescing green, nice solid green color. If you've got two T alleles, they're both going to be bonding to these A beads, they're both going to be a nice solid red color. If you've got a G coming from one parent and a T coming from the other, then some of the beads that are C are going to fluoresce green, some of the beads that are A are going to fluoresce red, and that person's going to be a heterozygous and they'll have this yellow color. So these colors are then representing the three possible genotypes at that locus in the genome. And then these here are for hundreds of thousands of different loci in the genome. What I've got in this particular slide are examples of genotyping intensities. So this is how we're going to look at the color clusters representing the different genotypes and see whether or not there are any problems. Now this is typically done by a genotyping company. You will probably not be doing this, but they will give you information about these first steps of quality control at this stage. So you know what's going on with your data. It'll be there in a report from the company. This top left-hand corner is a really good example of what we're looking for. We have three nice separated clusters. This is a homozygous A allele. This is a heterozygous group of individuals. And this is homozygous for the other allele. And in these two examples, with the little black X's, they are representing missing data. So missing data may not be terribly problematic if there's just a little bit of missingness and it's across all the different genotypes. However, if it is biased to one allele or one genotype, then that's going to interfere with our allele frequencies in our sample. And that is going to mean that it's not going to be representative of the population. It's not representative in terms of how we can actually test for this genotype against this phenotype. We don't want to have biased information about allele calling or genotype calling. Down here in the bottom left-hand corner, we have an example of a rare genotype. So it is a rare allele as well as a rare genotype. So there's only one individual here who's homozygous for the A allele, very few heterozygous. In the middle down the bottom, this would be an example of a monomorphic group at this locus. So it really isn't a useful locus for us to have genotyped. Or it could be that just this population is, there's no variation in this population at this locus. And in the right hand bottom corner, we have an example where there's really been a failure to call the genotypes correctly. There is no indication of any red color, which is representing the heterozygous group of people. We've got these two kind of green clusters, and the missingness is all off on this cluster. It's a complete fail. So the steps that we're going to be going through with our quality control tutorial is we're going to start off by checking the data. We're going to have a look at the file format. How is data coded? How is missingness coded? We're going to look at the build so that we know what assembly our data is on. The genotyping company would have provided us with that, but you might not always have access to that information. So there are ways that we can check that out ourselves. This is a very useful resource, which we will use in the tutorial to do that. And knowing what build your data is on is very important, particularly for meta-analysis, but also if you're going to do any follow-up analyses with or follow-up work with your results. We'll be doing a sex check, which is to check that the sex that we can infer from the genetic information is matching the sex reported by the individuals. So this check is looking at the heterozygosity of the X chromosome, and we have different expectations depending on whether an individual has one or two X chromosomes. So if the individual is reporting their sex and the genetic information comes back and it doesn't match, and that happens for a lot of your sample, then you might have a problem with the information that is matching your genetic information that has been returned by after genotyping to your participant IDs. Bear in mind, this is about biological sex and not about gender. We'll be checking for missingness. So there's two types of missingness that we'll check for. One is this one, the genotyping call rate. This is where SNPs are missing information on individuals. So for each SNP, we want to have information coming from most of our individuals. If there is too much missing data for that SNP, so too many individuals did not have information that was called correctly for that SNP, then that SNP might not be a good SNP for us to be using in our analyses. We'll have a look at the Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium to see whether or not our allele frequencies are matching what we expect. So this can highlight whether we've got some bias in terms of the frequency of alleles, or perhaps in our terms of calling genotypes appropriately, thinking back to those genotyping intensities. We'll be checking the minor allele frequency. So this is to make sure that we have enough information to do statistical analyses. If it's too rare, then our Gwise is not the appropriate tool to use, perhaps for this particular locus. We'll be having a look at sample call rate. So this is another form of missingness. This is to say, do all of our individuals have information across almost all of their SNPs? So we don't want individuals to be missing too much information across many SNPs. We'll be looking at the proportion of heterozygosity. So this is a way of checking. Think back to that sample where we had two people spitting into the same kit. That's going to give us too much variation. There'll be way too much variation in that DNA sample. So a heterozygosity would be excessive. Inversely, reduced heterozygosity could be an example of inbreeding, but it could also just be that we had lots of missing data. So that's one of the reasons we're going to check our missingness first before we do our heterozygosity check, because we don't want to be making, or we don't want to be setting ourselves up to have potentially making inferences that have social consequences that are negative. So if you've got missing data and that's the reason you have reduced heterozygosity, you don't want to end up looking at your sample going, oh, there's lots of inbreeding here. Towards the end of the tutorial, after we've cleaned it, we'll then have a look at the relationship structure in our data. So we might have lots of families, or we might have extended families. We want to know whether or not our individuals are related so that we can apply the right type of statistical analyses. And finally, we'll be having a look at population structure or stratification. So that will be talked about more in another one of the sessions, but this is when we have a look at allele frequencies. There is differences in allele frequencies across different groups and different populations. And that is an important thing for us to be aware of and to be including appropriately in our analyses. Elsewise, we're going to get false positives and false negatives. If your population structure is also correlated in some way with your outcome of interest, that's where we're going to get a problem, and that's when we're going to talk about it in terms of population stratification. So these are going to be our checklists for our key steps in QC that we'll be running through in the tutorial.